of post-baccalaureate certificate program. If those of us gathered in this room today could decide in the hour or so we have this morning that we'd like to offer a certificate in something or other, we could do that. And it would depend on just a few things. It would depend, A, on our, being able to decide what that certificate was going to be in, what area it was going to be in. But mainly, it would depend on our being able to convince people to pay us for it, and on them being able to believe that they could convince employers to pay them for having it. That's a brief definition of certificate programs. I don't mean to be cynical about certificates, because I think it's an extremely important part of education, extremely important part of graduate education. But let's just talk very broadly about what the experience has been. There are certificate programs that last a weekend, certificate programs that last a couple of months, certificate programs that last 2 years or more. And again, going back to my own experience at Ohio State, there were two graduate certificates offered through the graduate school at Ohio State. One was in Latin American studies and the other was in Slavic studies. And these were two-year full-time postmaster's programs. These were tough, demanding academic programs. And area studies has been one part of higher ed that has been particularly prone to use a certificate approach. And the basic issue is pretty straightforward. You're a political scientist or an economist or in some area, in some field of study, but you're particularly interested in Latin America or in Asia or in Eastern Europe. And so what you do is you get a certificate in that particular field, which gives you a much broader base from which to operate in your own particular area of interest. Social scientists have used certificate programs for a long, long time. However, this is going much beyond the social sciences this time. So first of all, certificate programs can be for any length of time. There is no certificate. The other thing that perhaps is most interesting to the academic community is, as I mentioned a moment ago, anybody can offer a certificate program. It doesn't have to be a university that offers a certificate program. One of the key players in this particular area would be professional societies that routinely offer certificate programs to people in that profession for all kinds of educational accomplishments. Certificates tend to recognize fairly well-defined, clear-cut objectives and then provide you with a piece of paper that says you have satisfied whatever the particular requirements are and you know something about that type of area. Very responsive, very flexible. For example, two of the hot certificate programs today are in webmastering and network. There were no certificate programs in web mastering and network management 10 years ago. We didn't have that 10 years ago. That's very big business today. Not for universities. Most universities aren't in depth. For private entrepreneurs who see a market that attend and who are responding to that market. So there's a lot of competition out there. There are many vendors who are providing certificates. And certificates come back to the old question of validation of educational experience. It's not enough to say that you know this stuff. You have to have something from someone or some entity that's regarded as credible that validates what you have achieved educationally. This is very, very big business. It is fairly easy to put together. That is, you can mount certificate programs and dismount them very easily. At an institute like New Jersey Institute of Technology, for example, they work very closely with local industry. Local industry says, we'd like to have a certificate program for our employees in hydraulic landing gear systems. Fine, you can put that together using people from the industry and using your own engineering faculty. You put that together as long as there's a demand for it. You give it, and the demand disappears, off the books it goes, and you do other things. Very flexible, very interesting arrangements. The big question about certificate program, of course, is, what role do universities play in that? Universities compete in every marketplace. Are there places where universities say, no, that's not our business, that's someone else's business, it's valid, you need this kind of stuff, but we're not going to do that. How do universities make those decisions? Big question. In doctoral education, a lot of degrees, the number of degrees have been going up every year since 1986 to what they are now, currently 424. 47% women, which is a remarkable figure, and that means U.S. citizen women. If you include all PhDs, a significant percentage of Fulbright students affects that figure because most of the Fulbright students in this country are male rather than female. But if you look at just U.S. citizens, about 47% women, the other figures are pretty straightforward. And for a whole variety of reasons, not always clear, doctoral education dominates the national press. When there are discussions of graduate education, if you see an article in the New York Times or even the Chronicle of Higher Education for that matter, with a title like graduate education, you can almost bet that what it's reading will be about is doctoral education. It's interesting, it's also interesting to me at least, to note that if you look at the education supplements of the New York Times and the Washington Post, and last week was education supplement, they never have any articles about graduate education, and all of the advertisements are about master's education or certificate programs. Almost all of the advertisements, because that's where the action is. But no discussion of these. And again, it reflects a general satisfaction of the public that those particular degrees. At the doctoral level, however, all kinds of discussion and concerns, both quantitative and qualitative. And if I could express these in a rather straightforward manner, there have been four quantitative concerns about doctoral education for the last 10 years or so. And very simply, they are, many people feel that we have, A, too many PhDs, that we have too many foreign students, that we have not enough minority students, and not enough women. Those are purely quantitative issues. And there's been a great deal of discussion of all of them. The too many PhD business, we're right in the heart of that now and have been for the last 4 or 5 years, because the academic job market has not been good for the last few years. But even so, we knew about humanism about that in 3 years. I mean, it's no big surprise that, there have not been a lot of jobs for humanists. But again, remember that A, doctoral education dominates the discussion, and B, science and engineering dominate that particular subset of the discussion. And all the action, all the interest came into this topic about 5 years ago when articles started appearing that said physicists, engineers, mathematicians weren't getting jobs. And then the topic grew up, and everyone was interested. Too many foreign students, again, fascinating issue. How many is too many? We were talking about that earlier today. Should departments exist where all the students are foreign students? That's a tough question, particularly for public institutions. Why do foreign students come to this country? Well, the general wisdom on that, particularly in the past, has been for two reasons. One, the quality of U.S. graduate education is generally recognized as being top-notch around the world. But the other issue is a very practical reason. It's capacity. There are no other countries that have the capacity for doctoral education that we have in this country. There are so many places you can go to get graduate education here that that's a very good reason to come to the United States to do this. Situation appears to be changing, at least a little bit now. I was mentioning to someone earlier this morning that in China, there is a plan called the 211 plan, just announced recently by the Chinese government, to establish by the year 2010 100 research class universities in China. And you can bet that the Chinese are going to be particularly interested in keeping their own students at home, getting degrees in those institutions. So that scene is changing. Too few women, again, graduate education historically, doctoral education particularly, has been seen predominantly as the main of white males, changing. The 47% women figure is an astounding change over the last 20 years. And then the other issue is U.S. minorities, and every year for the past few years, both enrollments and degrees have gone up, but we're talking about a very, very small percentage and a very, very major issue in this country of having to do with minorities in graduate education and faculty positions. And I'll return to that a little bit later. A few years ago, 1995, a very interesting study was done, and it's a good example, I think, of the fact that the way you title studies and where they come from direct their readership very often. Many people might ignore this. This is a publication called Reshaping the Graduate Education of Scientists and Engineers. From graduate read doctoral, although there's a little bit about masters in that. But the problem with the title is if you're not a scientist or engineer, you might not read that, and that would be a mistake. Because a lot of what's in there has to do with graduate education broadly defined. It's a publication by the Committee on Science, Engineering, and Public Policy of the National Academies, and the acronym for that committee is COSIPA. and among its devotees, it's often referred to as the Kosapa report. I would guess that the majority of people here have not read the Kosapa report, and I'm not going to go through the whole thing. But it responds pretty much to the kinds of both quantitative issues and certainly some of the qualitative issues that are related to graduate education. And in addition to just a few specific recommendations, makes some very broad recommendations. For example, and the major one in the Coast Public Report is broaden the graduate educational experience of graduate students. There is a concern that graduate students, particularly doctoral students, are coming out too narrowly focused, not just on their field, but on their subfield and on their dissertation research. And this is creating many, many problems. For one, when they go out to seek faculty jobs, and when your molecular biologist who has been looking at something happening in the cell wall for the last 6 years goes out and interviews at a liberal arts college and is told that he or she will have to teach biology 101, that person is very often completely flabbergasted by that experience. I never even thought of that experience. As I talk to colleagues of mine who are provosts and deans of faculties at either small regional institutions or liberal arts colleges, they say they see this every day as they talk about faculty hiring. That they talk about people who are very bright, very smart, and who are basically unprepared to think about teaching more broadly outside of their own field. And if you talk to people in industry, a general complaint is that many graduate students come and interview for jobs, and what the student wants to do is talk to the team leader about what I did for my dissertation. And what the team leader wants to talk about is what kind of problems we have in this company and what we would like you to work on and tell us how you can help us with what we do. So there's a whole issue here about trying to broaden the education. And a lot of schools are doing a lot of things. Clearly, this is not just an issue for scientists and engineers. It extends much more broadly than that. And schools that for years had not had minors are reintroducing the concept of the minor. Some institutions, University of Colorado Boulder is an example, has introduced a whole bunch of certificate programs designed specifically to be adjuncts to either doctoral or master's program. An example might be a certificate program in environmental policy, for example, where the idea is if you're a chemist or a physicist or a geologist or an economist or a political scientist and you would like to broaden your background a little bit and perhaps give you a shot at a broader range of jobs, adding a certificate in environmental policy to any of those disciplines, if you think about it for a moment, makes a certain amount of sense if you're interested and gives you a whole range of other things to look at. So there's a good deal of examination and programming going on. Another idea is to try to develop some kind of human resource policy. Very difficult to do. That is talking about the relationship between graduate education, jobs, and careers, and to try to look at this in some sort of policy sense. How many X will we need in the year 2004? That's been a dismally disappointing exercise over the years, largely because the lag period between going to graduate school and getting out is about 6 to 8 years, depending on the field. And too many different things intervene, too many things happen during that period of time. A very important part of the Coast Book report is that graduate departments should be providing more information about careers and more information about options in graduate school to students. And I think that's incredibly important. A lot of ways to do that. One is to bring back former students who are doing different things, to talk to students and faculty in your departments. Again, you can expand on that in a variety of ways, but it turns out, coming back to something I said a few moments ago, that many students and many faculty have the idea that there's one thing and one thing only that you can do with this degree. And if you don't do that, your life isn't worthwhile and you're probably a failure. And that's a devastating thing and a tremendous waste of human potential. Another recommendation in the COSPA report is to improve mentoring and advising. And that's a given. That goes without saying. There's a lot of concern about the relationship between graduate students and their advisors, whether it's as good as it should be. Obviously, we have a gamut here that runs from very bad to exceptionally good, with most of it occurring about in the middle. But it's something up front. It's something to think about. And the concept of mentoring, which has been discussed a lot in the last few years, of course, goes a little bit beyond simply advising students, but actually caring about what happens to students and being involved as, in the true sense of the word, a mentor. Let's go on to say a word about postdocs. That figure of 26,000 is probably off by 100%. There are at least 50,000 postdocs in the United States, I would say. The NSF maybe doesn't include medical schools, which is a huge source of opportunities for postdocs, and also a broader definition of postdocs. But postdocs find themselves in a very difficult position these days. First of all, in some fields, particularly fields like chemistry, physics, many biological sciences, it's almost impossible to get a tenure-track position in a research university without some postdoctoral experience. And it used to be a year of postdoctoral experience, then it became 2 years of postdoctoral experience. Now it's 3 years of postdoctoral experience, with many people taking two of those, or maybe more. And the question is, if you have a postdoc, do you have a job? And that's a very good question. I mean, you got your degree and you're out working somewhere doing research in your field. You're not making a lot of money. And you have no job security whatsoever for the most part, because chances are you are being paid for someone's grant. And if that grant is not renewed, you're in big trouble. And if that grant is not renewed, not only do you lose your postdoc position, but you probably don't have health benefits anymore either. And I speak to that with some feeling, because I have a very good friend whose son and daughter-in-law are both biologists and have been postdocing for a while and happen to have a child with a chronic heart problem. And they're in big trouble most of the time. In fact, what's happening with this particular couple now is he is working at something not in his field in order to provide money for her to get her law degree, because they have had trouble finding permanent positions in their field. And they've got a lot of problems. So we don't know what to do about postdocs. It's a holding tank. People are taking postdoc positions waiting for job opportunities to come up. They do, postdocs do a lot of wonderful things. Obviously, most of them are very good. Researchers, they do all kinds of stuff, papers and so on. But it's also become fairly clear that the longer you postdoc beyond a certain point, the smaller your chances are of getting full-time faculty position, because you're getting too old. You're too far down on the curve. So a very complicated issue, one that we'll have to talk about a great deal before we figure out where we're going to go on. Well, let me now talk about two issues, and I'll try to go through these fairly quickly. One is the question of graduate education and the job market. And the job market is a wonderful kind of non-defined term. And all of these parts of graduate education, certificates, master's degrees, doctorate degrees, postdocs, et cetera, refer to the job market in some way, and the job market refers to anything that you might end up doing in your life. And it would really make more sense to talk about careers, and I'll come back to that in just a moment. Again, here, a lot of the interest has been focused on doctoral degrees, very little on master's degrees, for the very simple reason that most master's students have jobs. We're not talking about getting jobs. If 70% of master's students are attending school part-time, they're doing that for the most part because they're working someplace. So they have jobs, and they're talking about career advancements. There are two very broad concerns about the job market, really. First of all, what is it? And what it has been primarily is academia at the doctoral level, industry at the doctoral level, industry at the master's level. To some extent, academia at the master's level, depending on what part of academia you're talking about. A lot of people who teach at community colleges have master's degrees. Government, and then, of course, in any particular area, we always talk about other. And one of the interesting things is other is getting bigger and bigger all the time. But overlaid on that are two issues. One is the economy, and the other has to do with aspirations. And relative to the economy, we're in that interesting situation today where we came through a very bad economic period at the beginning of this decade. And the key word for everybody was downsizing. Industry downsized, business downsized, universities downsized. And what downsizing really meant was not necessarily that they got smaller, but what they were doing was trying to do more things with less people, fewer people. So a lot of people lost jobs, industries cut back, and the universities at that point, and so on. Academic jobs became hard to get, jobs anyway became hard to get. Well, the economy is really not down anymore. The economy has been moving up. People are talking about a Dow of 10,000 pretty soon, and it's not beyond the realm of possibility that that will happen. But one of the things that seems to be a fact of the way human beings work is that economic conditions drive us to make changes, and then when economic conditions change, we very often can't reverse the other changes we've made to respond to the economic changes. A lot of people say, well, it's the bad economy that's caused us to change the nature of faculty to hire many, many more part-time faculty. Well, we have a good economy now. Does that mean we are not going to hire many, many more part-time faculty anymore? I don't think so. I think that's becoming part of the way universities are going to work, and we're going to have to look very carefully at the implications. Universities very rarely cut back on programs in times when there's a lot of money around, even though some programs probably should be cut back, regardless of how much money is there. But when there's not too much money, it offers a good opportunity to cut back some programs that you might have wanted to cut back years ago. These are hard things to talk about, but the economy serves to basically give us reasons for doing some things very often that we would like to do anyway. There is a study going on that I talked to people earlier about this morning that is going to provide some very interesting information here. It's a study being done at the Graduate School of the University of California, Berkeley. They are attempting to find, they have attempted to find, roughly 6,000 people who got their degrees in six disciplines, biochemistry, English, electrical engineering, political science, mathematics, and computer science, between 1983 and 1985, in roughly 60 universities in the United States. And they've sent these people a questionnaire, and the questionnaire basically says, what are you doing, how did you get there, and how do you think your graduate education relates to your career? In addition to this, the questionnaire, there have been about 120 personal interviews with people in areas of high PhD concentration. That means the Bay Area in San Francisco, the Boston Cambridge area, the Washington DC area, and a couple of others. Very interesting things that will be out of this study. A huge number of people in this particular cohort have, in that 10-year period, probably three different kinds of jobs as part of their career. And why they move from one thing to another is usually not clear on just looking at the raw data. I sat with a group that looked at some of that, and it was fascinating to see because, as I said to someone earlier this morning, it became almost like one of those Sherlock Holmes stories, you know, where a person walks in the room and Sherlock Holmes says, well, I see you just spent 3 years in a small town in India on our left hand, and et cetera, et cetera. And you go, how did you do that? We would see these patterns go forward. Student, got a degree in 1984, several years, tenure track position, left that to do something else, and the other one in the audience said, aha, left that means you were only looking to get tenure. In this particular case, it turned out that wasn't the case at all. So it's a very complex situation. The messages from it are that, at least at this point, are that 10 years after you get your degree, a lot of students are doing things that they never would have imagined that they would be doing when they got their degree, and certainly not when they started graduate school. That life has changed, that they have changed, and they're doing a variety of different things. Most of them are pretty well satisfied with what they're doing. Most of them are working somewhere close to their fields, their broad fields. And that might mean that if you got your PhD in English and you're working in the publishing industry, you're working close to your broad field. If you're an editor somewhere, you're working close to your broad field. Most of them thought their graduate education was pretty good, but many, many of them, and I haven't seen all the data at least yet, are saying if there was one thing they could change, they wish it had been broader. Without sacrificing the depth, they wish it had broadened them out. Now, that's very difficult. Then you have to start talking about time to degree. And there are a lot of ways to talk about that, too. But students have liked the research experience, liked the intensity of the research experience. But as they've lived out there for 10 years in a variety of different settings, they found that they wish it had been somewhat broader. The other thing that many of them have found was, and again, something we talked about earlier, was that, and this is expressed by a man named John Armstrong, who was the former vice president for research at IBM, ways much better than I can do it. He said most graduate students don't know what it is that they really know. What they think they know is how to solve very specific and highly technical problems. And what they really know is how to formulate questions and get to partial answers based on very strong fundamental principles. And I think that's a very good statement of what graduate education really is about. And what it says is that if you can do that, if you know at some point that that's what you know, that you can analyze situations, that you can tell them when something written or something spoken is utter nonsense, when you can try to figure out what you want to do with your life and analyze that and think about what questions you have to ask and how to get the answers to those questions. That opens up a broad range of possibilities for everyone concerned. So I think that this is becoming extremely important. The other big issue is student it's aspirations. And a couple of ways to look at that. Some of you know that every 2 years, Sandy Aston at UCLA does a big survey of thousands of freshmen. And it's on freshman attitudes, and that's published just a few months ago, I think. And one of the questions on that survey every 2 years is, what is the highest degree that you think you can phrase something like that? And very, very consistent, about 60% of those college freshmen say master's degree, and about 15% say a doctoral degree. Now, I don't think that happens. I don't think that 60% get master's degrees, although maybe get close to that. I know that 15% of all the college graduates in the don't get doctoral degrees. But there is an aspiration. There is a feeling that would be a good thing to do. And it's interesting to think about why that might be. And I've kind of concluded that for students, it's the idea of professionalism defined in three different ways. One is the idea of professionalism as it relates to administration and management. And that is to say that if I get a bachelor's degree, I can get an entry-level job. But if I want to move up from what I can see around me, I probably have to get a master's degree. And the classic, of course, if you're in the business world, is to get an MBA. And that's why schools are filled with thousands of students working part-time with an MBA, because they want to move up. They want to be in the administration of the managerial. A second, totally different idea is if you want to practice as a professional. And that is, if you want to be a social worker, if you want to teach, if you want to do a whole variety of things, you have to get a master's degree in order to practice that particular profession. But the third type of professionalism is professional as distinct from amateur. And that's a very important distinction. If you're an historian, you can be an historian without being a university professor. You can read and write history in your spare time and be a stockbroker or whatever else you want to do. But I think a lot of people like history would like to be professionals, and that is they'd like someone to pay them for reading about history and writing about history and teaching about history. And what that means for most people is they'd like university teaching jobs. So there's a great deal to aspire to here, and the combination of aspiration and the economy is always struck me as kind of interesting. One other point in terms of aspirations, and that is institutional aspirations. The number of doctoral granting institutions in this country continues to increase. For many universities, offering doctoral degrees has become basically a sign of academic credibility. And I think we have created far too many doctoral programs in this country. And it's very, very difficult to deal with because it's been ingrained in the faculty and the institutional ethos in so many places that really have got I visited an institution some years ago that started out, the state plan was for it to be a doctoral granting institution, and they hired a number of department chairs, and they hired a number of faculty members, and then the state plan changed, and they are not just a predominantly master's, but a master's only institution. I went there to basically the same thing I'm doing here, talk to faculty and students and to get some idea of what was going on. And it was an incredible experience. I have never seen a group of faculty so dispirited, feeling that they had been misled, feeling that what they were doing was not what they signed on for and was worthless. And what they were doing actually was a pretty good job of teaching students at a variety of levels, just not the doctoral level. The idea was so strong. And the lesson of the doctoral level was really good. It was really very strange. Okay, I got to move along. This is stuff, as you can see, that's probably easy to talk about, so you can talk about it forever. Let me just focus for a few moments on the hot topic of the day, which is distance ed and technology. One of the interesting contrasts here is between the words asynchronous and interactive, which define the two ends of a continuum. There's a lot of interactive stuff going on. What we're doing right here today is almost interactive. You haven't said anything yet. I've been talking, but it could be interactive. It certainly is synchronous in that we're both here at the same time in this room. We could do this in a variety of other ways. We could do it on interactive audio or video where you could be in a variety of different places sitting looking at a television screen. I could be someplace else and we could be hooked up. And the technology for this gets better and better all the time, and you're probably doing some of that at Ball State. I don't know what state you are. We could also do this asynchronously. Now, the old way you did asynchronous stuff was with books. In other words, you had a book and you read it at the bed at night, and you read it on airplane, and you read it through a tree on a nice day. And you certainly weren't in the same place as the person who wrote the book. And it was true asynchronous learning made possible by technology, the printing press. What we mean by asynchronous learning today is a little bit different. But it still comes down to the same thing. It's basically out of time. It has nothing to do with your time. It's on your own time. It's on your own place. And you are not in the same place as the teacher at the same time. The internet has been very involved with this sort of thing. And the internet can be either synchronous or asynchronous. You can involve the chat rooms and things like that. But a lot of the stuff on the internet is basically asynchronous. And then, of course, you have video cassettes and audio cassettes and books and all the rest. The technology issues, I think, we are getting past. The technology advances, not just advances, but the incredible advances in technology are given. We're going to see more and more. 10 years from now, if we were to look back at what we have today and then look at what we have 10 years from now, none of us can predict what that will be. It'll be astounding. It'll be amazing. What we don't know about any of that comes down to these two levels. We're not quite sure what it costs. The first information in is that when everyone gets all excited about this instead of technology as a cost saver, it usually doesn't work out that way. It's just like saying when we all got computers, the costs were going to go down and we'd have all this extra time because of how fast the computers are. And of course, as you know, what has happened is just the opposite. The costs are up. And we found many more things to do. Same things are going to happen. Convenience, very, very big issue. Very big issue. There's public out there that is more and more interested in learning on their own terms, in their own places, on their own time, and they want somehow for this to be provided. As I said before, with a market as large as that appears to be, there are a lot of people interested in that. Let me just give you a very broad idea. The figures aren't very good in this area. According to what I find out, there are about 45 million people in the United States who have bachelor's degrees. 45 million. It appears from some figures that the National Center for Educational Statistics gathers that probably around 10% of those people are engaged in some kind of educational activity that A, is not degree-oriented, and B, is not recreational in intent. In other words, we're not talking about winemaking and fly fishing and things like that. Some kind of business. 10% of 45 million is 4.5 million people. There are, as I said earlier, about 1.4 million people without these folks. Where are all the rest of those folks? And what are they doing? And who's providing that education for them and under what conditions? So, interesting. Credit transfer of credit. Very interesting issue. What's involved here is what I think about as virtual consortium. And that is that you can be a student at Ball State, and you can be signed up for two courses, and you can also take another course from Monterey Tech in Mexico, which has an absolutely spectacular array of distance ed courses, very high quality, very, very good. And you might be taking another course from Athabasca University in Canada, which does a lot in this country in terms of distance ed. And you might be taking another course from, you name it, NYU. At NYU, you can get a PhD in information management, totally uploading. So you might be doing all of that stuff, and at some point, you're going to want to give that to somebody and say, give me a degree for that. What that amounts to is that you have put together your own consortium, but they don't know anything about it. You're the only one that knows something about it. There hasn't been any agreement among those institutions, certainly, on what credit transfers, how credit is viewed in terms of program, and so on. A classic example of one of the problems with this, now I understand the Ball State University is sort of sitting out on it at this point and watching with interest, is the Western Governors University, which is state of Indiana. Many of the institutions that we have just joined. And as some of you know, Western Governors is seeking accreditation to be, in essence, a default degree provider. And that is, what if you take these courses at a number of different places and want to get a degree? Who gives you the degree? And every institution has some kind of rule about that, that says if you're going to get a degree from our place, we will only accept so many hours, whatever, of transfer credit. But what if none of them? What if it doesn't match any of them? Western Governors University has said we need to grow them, consider that because we have a degree ourselves. So it's not just a brokerage operation, but it's a degree operation. Quality control, always an issue. The degree issues we're talking about right now. Accreditation, a regional professional, another interesting issue. The North Central Association had a big discussion several years ago of how you credit virtual universities. How do you credit Walden in Minneapolis, which is a virtual university? So we have no campus, we have no faculty. I think the standard accreditation model is to talk about bricks and mortar, and talk about faculty, but what if those don't exist? How do you look at accreditation? A lot of things that we're really working on, trying to figure out answers to. Well, my time is drawing to a close. I want to talk for just a moment about one issue, and then sort of sum up. And that one issue is what's going on and being discussed in this country about affirmative action. We're, of course, at a very interesting time right now. Many of you have been reading in the public press and in the education press about what's happening at the University of California as the figures come in. I don't think anyone has any good answers on this issue. It's astounding to read, for example, that among freshman applicants who did not get in to the University of California this year, there were 800, I'm not sure, I have to check, either 800 minority students or 800 African American students, one of the two, who had 4-point averages and SAT scores above 1,200, who did not, were not accepted in the University of California. Now, University of California, Berkeley, has probably 25,000 applicants for about 2,000 seats. They have many more applicants who are clearly qualified for admission, almost anywhere, than they can possibly admit. And it brings you up against a very, very difficult question. If that's the case, and increasingly in many places it is the case, how do you make rational admissions decisions? I mean, can you look at that whole situation? It turns out that in California, you can have more than a 4-point average by doing certain things, by getting involved in advanced placement activities and so on. So how do we even begin to think of this situation? There was another very interesting discussion in an article in the Wall Street Journal earlier this week that says, well, what we're really interested in, though, is not the question of who we offer admission to, but who graduates, how many people graduate. And one could speculate that even though the number of students to whom admission is being offered is smaller, there's a higher likelihood that those students who are offered admission will graduate. And that may mean that the yield is higher. I had the unenviable assignment of participating in a meeting about a week and a half from now at Howard University on the question of how will changes in affirmative action affect doctoral education opportunities for African Americans. And it's not an easy question to answer. Because one could say, could increase, don't know. Could decrease, don't know. If you take the position of yield, and say, well, if the number of enrollees at the undergraduate level isn't the controlling factor, a much more important issue is how many people get baccalaureate degrees. And a much more important issue of that, then, is how many of those go to graduate school, and of those who go to graduate school, how many complete the programs. And it's hard to tell what's going to happen with that. It's an issue that we as a Council of Graduate Schools are very, very concerned about. The position that we've taken on this issue is that inclusivity in a graduate community is extremely important. It involves every kind of diversity you can think about as a factor in the kind of things we do in graduate school, which is looking at the world and trying to understand how it works. And that if affirmative action impedes us these days from doing what we want to do, then we'll have to find other ways, or if the loss of affirmative action impedes our ability to do what we want to do, then we'll have to find other ways to do it in order to ensure that students with the ability and with the desire have the opportunity to learn and continue their education as far as they go to education. So that's an issue that will be consuming the graduate community, I think, for several years to come. And something we're ought to have to be involved with. To finish up, then, it's the intersection of student aspirations and public policy that gets to be most interesting, I think, to consider. I told the story to some folks earlier, and I'll tell it again, and I apologize to those who I told it to. It was about a young man who got a degree, a PhD in astronomy at the University of Texas about 2 years ago. And did an exceptional dissertation for which we gave him an award that we give every year along with University of Microfilms for an outstanding dissertation. And he talked to us a little bit at our national meeting about why he went into astronomy and what he thought about graduate education. And he was a very enthusiastic young man. He was postdocing at the time, looking for a job. He said that he loved astronomy from the time he was a kid. He loved graduate school. He was amazed that he go to graduate school free, which he couldn't because he had a TA or an RA appointment, and that actually paid him a stipend. But he said that if he had known when he entered graduate school that he would never get a job as an astronomer, he would have done it anyway, because these were the best 6 years that he had ever had in his life. And whatever else happened to him, he would have those 6 years. And if you can imagine that talk to an audience of about 450 graduate deans, people would fall off their chairs. Tears were people were dissolving. This was wonderful. It was just a wonderful thing. As we talked about that later, and tried to think about it a little bit, two things were going on there. One is what he was saying, if I can paraphrase it, was, is it better to have loved and lost than never to have loved and lost? That's basically what he was saying. And he was saying, yes, absolutely, absolutely. No matter what I do from now on, if I end up washing cars, I will be different from all the other folks who are washing cars because I will have had that 6 years doing astronomy. And that's true. Then you lay the public policy question on top. And you say, you know, it's pretty expensive to maintain graduate programs in astronomy. If you're not going to turn out people who have a chance of getting jobs as astronomers, what's the argument for doing that? I can tell you that in the recent review of doctoral programs in the state of Ohio, one of the questions asked in the survey was, are these people, what percentage of people are working in their fields? And the implication was, if you got a degree in chemistry and were not doing chemistry, you didn't count. as a product of that program because you weren't doing what you were trained to do. Are there issues out there in value education? Yes, there are a lot of issues to think about and talk about. I think it's a very exciting time in graduate education because everything is changing so fast, and the only thing we have to rely on comes back to the statement I made a little earlier, and that is, it's not so much our ability to deal with the specifics, which change all the time, but our ability to try to figure out if we or anyone else is asking the right questions, and if the way that we're looking at getting answers to those questions is indeed providing us with those answers, and what our values tell us to do with those answers when we get them. So thank you very, very much. It's been a pleasure.
We have time for questions and comments.
In regard to the number of minorities that you have, 15% are minorities. What is the overall population of the population of the minorities that you would count as minorities?
Well, very Of course, one of the interesting things about admissions offers is the relationship between offers and admissions at the moment. And generally speaking, if you rank order your individuals on whatever way you want to do that, for admission, you can expect that the percent of a particular institution will increase as you go further and further down the list. Because the individual at the top of the list will be offered admission by any institution that they apply to. One of the things we're going to have to cope with at some point in higher education is how we look at admissions. We use all kinds of proxies for admissions, and they don't do a very good job in giving us an idea of what if any, are the critical indicators for success in graduate
school. Well, another question that I had was in regard to the foreign students that they are admissions, especially the fees for especially in the field like chemistry, where you hire a lot of your graduate students to teach, and with a relatively cheap hands, or say from a lot of sciences. What you're feeling about this, of course, the pros and cons regarding the attraction of the foreign students. What do you think about the sales of these people here?
Well, a couple of ways to answer that. For the most part, it's been my impression that there, at the graduate level, there has not been a lot of active recruiting of foreign students. It hasn't been necessary for the most part. Many departments have many, many more foreign student applicants than they can accept. At the undergraduate level, it's very often a different issue. And one of the reasons it's a different issue has to do with money. Undergraduates very often come and pay the university. Graduate students often come and the university pays them. So, I mean, they evolve, but there is that. What argument has always been that we should look, the university community should look to make the best possible students. And on standard criteria, very often in some fields, particularly the quantitative fields, foreign students are out the roof in terms of their GRE scores or anything else that you want to look at that. But the question is that the best educator we have for graduates? Foreign students are very, very successful in their graduate programs. Their graduation rates are very, very high. Their times for completion are lower than American students for the most part. They do very, very well. Faculty, for the most part, are very happy to have foreign students in their laboratories. And most foreign students are in their laboratory in engineering and sciences. There was a very interesting article by the chairman of biochemistry at the University of Pittsburgh 6 or 7 months ago, who feels that very definitely the number of foreign students in this country is depressing the number of opportunities for minorities. And his position is not that he believes this is true, not because of an overtly racist idea. It's just so easy to get lots of very, very well qualified foreign students that the easiest path of least resistance is to take them, and they do very well in our program. What he has suggested, and I doubt that he'll be followed up, but what he has suggested is that the National Science Foundation, the National Institutes of Health, pull all of the research assistant money out of research grant budgets and put it into institutional training grants, and that money be distributed on institutional grounds, having to do with other factors than just scores and so on and so forth. So that almost says we get into a position then where nationality becomes a factor in what we are going to work for. But it's been a complicated issue for some time. Yes?
Is the argument made in Washington in any circles that you communicate in that there is a national foreign policy issue, that there are benefits derived from training in the United States of foreign nationals who then go back to their country with an Americanization and form links that are important in the national interest?
Absolutely. And it's an argument that's been made over the years, but there are two ways to go at that. One that is, it's pretty much as you have stated, that one of the benefits of our bringing many foreign students over here is they go back to their countries and very often assume leadership positions, business, industry, a variety of things. And they have left our country with some knowledge of the United States and how this country operates and works, and very often with a good deal of affection for this country. And in fact, there have been books written about this, a wonderful little book by two people named Crawford Goodwin and Michael Mack. Crawford Goodwin used to be a man at Duke and at the business school at the University of Maryland, called Fondness and Frustration. And it was about, particularly about Latin American students who go back to their countries, and Goodwin and Mack interviewed them. Enormous fondness for the United States, but very often found themselves operating in situations where they didn't have the equipment, the colleagues, and the wherewithal to do the kind of work they have been trained to do. So enormous frustration. Absolutely, that's right on top of you. The other side of that argument, the flip side, if you will, is wait a minute, we're operating in a global economy and we're competing with all these folks. Why are we training these individuals from other countries to go back and give all this American technology away to our competitors? Isn't that counterproductive? That argument really doesn't hold sway with many people. The issue of foreign students versus domestic minority students is one that is upfront all the time. My general view of that is that institutions do not take foreign students because they don't wish to take American minority students. It's to take foreign students because it's easier and they're very, very productive, and that many faculty members don't see themselves as agents of American foreign or domestic policy. They just want to get, they want to get their grants renewed, is what they want to do, and they're working to do that. I'll give you an example of an experience I had with foreign students when I was still in the state of Ohio. A member of the Ohio legislature introduced a bill that said foreign graduate students would no longer account for subsidy. That is, that the hours would not be turned in to the state. We're working on a subsidy model. It's interesting to note that 3 weeks ago I was at the University of Toledo, and the same bill has just been introduced in the legislature by a different legislature. Same, it comes up all the time. And we in the graduate school said, well, what we're going to do is find out all we can about all the students who graduated, foreign students who graduated from this institution, and show all the wonderful things that they're doing, both in this country and in their country. So we're spending a lot of time on this, compiling lists. This student got a degree in agronomy here, is back in Brazil, is leading a whole national effort, et cetera. It's wonderful, wonderful stuff. And then the same member of the legislature introduced a bill that would prohibit foreign cars from parking in the State House garage. And at that point, we understood what the issue was. And it didn't make any sense to go on compiling this list, because that was not what this was about at all. I mean, this was xenophobia, and that's what it was. So it plays back and forth. For a long time, the argument in this country was, it's fine for foreign students to come as long as they go back to their countries. Then the argument became, it's all right for foreign students to come here as long as they stay here, because American students are not going out in engineering and a lot of other fields, and we need foreign students in our industry to keep our industry going. And now we're sort of in the middle.
Yes, I'm wondering what trend you see in relation to the final pieces and research requirements nationally at the master's level, as well as qualifying examinations.
Well, at the master's level, there's been a sort of a steady decrease over the years in so-called thesis options for master's students. I don't know what the percentages are. It's hard to get, hard to get this information. I would guess that at least 60% of master's degrees, and probably closer to 70% of master's degrees, are non-thesis degrees. Now, one of the reasons it's so difficult is, what do you mean by thesis? What if there is a final paper to do? What if there's a project? Is that like a thesis or so on? And so the figures get fuzzy. But I think an increasing number of master's degrees have become coursework-only programs, occasionally with what's often called a culminating experience at the end of the program, where there's some course or another course that's supposed to bring together all of this stuff. Another question related to that today is, are we going to get to the point of considering certificate programs as modules? And could individuals get certificate programs and eventually essentially trade them in on the master's degree? And a lot of people are talking about that. Some people are saying, I'll give you a good example. If you, I live here in both areas. Well, very often, if you're in an institution, you're in military base. A lot of folks in the military come to the institution. Of course, it's kind of standard there, MBA or something. And what happens if all of a sudden you don't pull that? You have to go someplace else. Well, how do you deal with that? How do they deal with that in their lives? Classic instance of, here's a population that has certain constraints that say, they're doing very well in the course, but they have to leave tomorrow. They're going to Kuwait, wherever they need to go. How do they continue with their education? Well, we've got distance ed mechanisms today to do that. But we also might talk about repackaging it differently so they can carry segments of it to different places. But the big problem with that has to do with the basic philosophy of education. And it has to do with whether the sum, whether the whole is more than some. And if you believe that graduate programs may be what exists in the spaces in between the courses, then there's something else going on. It's not just a mathematical addition of the credits that you have, but it's much more of an architectural problem of how those things fit together in some way that makes it work. So those issues are right out front today. The other part that has to do with thesis and dissertations that's quite interesting today is Virginia Tech is leading a sort of movement to require all thesis and dissertations to be submitted in electronic form to be immediately available on the web. And this has all sorts of information. I was at Virginia Tech a few weeks ago. A lot of people are very enthused about it. Graduate students are, and even feeler and are somewhat apprehensive about it. Because one of the questions that comes up, we're all going to have to be dealing with this, is if my dissertation is published on the web, can I get an article accepted in the journal? Or will the journal have just told me it's already been published? And that's a very, very relevant question and varies from field to field. The first shot of that came out, although the position has changed now, I guess the American Company Society said, if you're published on the web, we won't accept the publication. But I understand that they modified that position now. But again, we're moving into an age where that's some variant of that is going to happen. And the question is, how are we going to deal with it? And how is it going to happen? Time for
one more question. This is kind of my bias on the public issue, public policy issue in terms of supporting graduate programs. I would hope public policy would be to support everyone to an oversupply, from the point of view that knowledge is very important. If we have enough people studying, working all areas, we have a chance to advance knowledge. And why should we shortchange any area? That would be my view of public policy.
And basically, I think I agree. I think it's always been in the best interest of any country to invest heavily in its smart little people. And say, go as far as you can go. Postback issue is an interesting issue in America. We've got an incredible resource in this country. We have probably 50,000 people who have wonderful training and education. And what we're saying is, we don't know what to do with them. Now, that's an interesting public policy issue. And perhaps, if there aren't enough academic jobs, perhaps we should be considering the development of things, the analogs to the Max Planck Institutes, or government, industry, business related organizations where people can go and do basic research, not just product oriented research. They have some experiments along the way. But how can we take a resource like this and give it away? Now, again, you've got to be careful not to define things too narrowly. A lot of these people are going to do a lot of very interesting things. One argument has been, from the point of view of home-based taxes, it's always been an investment for more education because it's very clear that employment is related to educational level. And regardless of what you say about overproduction PhDs today, PhDs have the lowest unemployment rate as a group of any other group. So that means you've got people out there paying taxes, putting money in the social security system, so on and so forth, which should be good for their lives. The human resource question, though, is the one I think we have to get past that says, people spend a lot of time studying, you know, that their lives, that they've wasted time. And how we look at this, how we try to understand that, and how people make their decisions. And that's what part of this article on document education being a risky business is about.
Jules, thank you very much for an excellent lecture. I want to again thank Bob Higgins for helping us set this up, and thank you all for coming. Bob.
Thank you.